Hi, everyone. We'd like to go ahead and get started here tonight. If you guys could find your seats, that'd be great. On behalf of Ottawa University and the Athletic Department, we'd just like to welcome you here tonight. It's a privilege, certainly, to have the opportunity to have Wayne Simien here on our campus to talk. Wayne was an outstanding basketball player, and as you'll be sure to gather here shortly, just an amazing person. And just from personal testimony, I know my son Cole had the opportunity to go up to his three-on-three basketball leagues a couple years, and I tell you what, it's just an amazing program that he runs up there in Lawrence. And not only did Cole come away with some great things in regards to basketball, but just the conversations that we had on the way home were amazing. Just he touched his life, and I really appreciate that. Tonight's event certainly wouldn't be possible without some special folks that have been very influential here at Ottawa University. They were during their time here as student athletes and have continued on with the Braves Athletic Hall of Fame. And we have a number of members here in attendance tonight. And if I could just have them stand and be recognized, I'd appreciate that. All members of the Braves Athletic Hall of Fame here in attendance tonight. At this time, I'm going to turn it over to Reverend Bud McClooney, our campus pastor, for the invocation. Thanks for being here.
Will you pray with me, please? Mighty God, you are the giver of all things. We give you thanks that we can be here tonight and we gather in this time of fellowship together. May our time together be insightful, that we better understand what it means to be called to greatness. Bless this time and help us to take what we learn and use it to help others. Thank you for Wayne and his ministry. Just bless him tonight. For we pray this in the name of Christ. Amen.
Thank you very much for being here tonight. I am speaking on behalf of the Braves Hall of Fame, Susan Jones, our current president, Dave Hill, our soon-to-be president. We thank you for the opportunity to share a great friend with you today. When I think of Wayne Simien, the first thing that comes to my mind, in spite of the great athletic career, is a committed Christian man who lives his faith. A strong Christian father and husband are the things that come to my mind first. Wayne has become a great friend, and we have spent some interesting times together. I think you all know, probably goes without saying, what an outstanding athletic career he had at the University of Kansas. He was an NCAA All-American twice, a Big 8, Big 12 player of the year, his senior year, winner of the Senior Class Award, which I frankly had something to do with when that was first initiated years ago, but it stands for someone who stays the course, who stays in school, and then graduates and conducts himself with great class. And I would say that's one of the other things that comes to mind when I think of Wayne Simien, a man of great class. He had obviously a great career in basketball and won the Golden Prize in the NBA in the 2005-2006 season with the Miami Heat. Went on to play some professional basketball in Spain, but along the way, he decided to commit his life and his ministry to an organization that he calls Call to Greatness. And it's not so much, as he explained to us today, it's not the organization that he's committed to, it's Jesus Christ. And so, with great pleasure, I'd like to introduce my friend Wayne.
All right. Am I on? Great. Ottawa Braves, what's up? Man, I've had a great time since I've been here. Got a chance to come in a little bit early and have some dinner. Nothing like some good cafeteria food every now and then. You guys like the Thanksgiving dinner a little bit early? Well, I get home cooking every night, so you guys are a little bit used to this, but I was having some dinner with some of the university dignitaries, and I was trying to keep it formal and official because I looked over to the cereal buffet, And when I was in college, like many of you, I basically lived off that. Crunch berries, my secret to athletic success, Captain Crunch crunch berries every night. So you guys looking to get that extra energy, that extra push in the fourth quarter, you guys can go ahead and tap into that. But it's been great being able to meet some of you out in the hallway, getting a chance to connect, hear your story, where you're from, how you got to Ottawa University, and probably the most humbling story was when I met my friend again, Cody Parks, who just mentioned to me that when he was in the sixth grade that I went up to his dorm and we were playing some PlayStation 2. Thanks for making me feel old, bro. Appreciate that. So, yeah, but I'm really, really excited to be here. I've had this date circled on my calendar for quite some time. It's been a huge day for me already. I was up at 5 a.m. To be at our KU team football practice. They had a 5 a.m. run stadium lights. The men's basketball team had their boot camp, their preseason conditioning at 6 a.m. Got a chance to connect with some other college students and do a little bit of a prayer meeting before they went to class, praying for the campus and some of their friends and family members to see God do great things on the KU campus. And then from about 9 to 1, I was on campus. I was doing individual Bible studies throughout the dorms, meeting with international students, and then I got a chance to go home and to spend some time with my wife and my family, Team Simien. And so some of you might be thinking, after that big-time day that I had, why would I want to come down here to Ottawa and spend the evening with you guys? And because you're worth it. And you guys are worth it. I know that I'm just now getting to meet a few of you. I know I've gotten a chance to talk to some of you guys on Twitter and social media before I came down. But you guys are worth it. You know, seeing you guys, hearing your story, hearing and seeing the purpose and destiny and calling that God has placed in your life, come down here to spend this evening with you and encourage you in your faith, to encourage you in your sport, and to being leaders and people of significance, as that's what Ottawa University has a heart to foster. And I absolutely love the college campus. Probably the main reason why I love the college campus, first of all, is because the college campus is actually where I encountered Jesus Christ, and that is actually where I began to follow him. In 2003, going into my junior year, I found myself in a place, 20 years old, and I had everything the world says should make you happy. I mean, we just gone to back-to-back Final Fours, back-to-back Big 12 championships. I was projected to go in the draft the next year. I had fame and notoriety. I had everything that the world said should make you happy. But little did people know that the guy that was on the ESPN highlights, the guy that was the so-called life of the party on Mass Street after big games, little did people know that that same guy was going back to his dorm room after big-time games, after big-time nights out on the town celebrating, and I was literally crying myself to sleep. Because everything that the world was telling me to go after, I had it. But yet it left me unfulfilled, broken, empty, and searching for a greater purpose. And so I began to ask God. I knew God was real. I didn't have a relationship with him, but I knew he was out there, and I knew he had created me to live for something greater than just myself and basketball. And so I asked for him, Lord, show me something greater to live for. And it was amazing. A few days later, outside of Wesco Hall, I was sitting on some steps in between class, and this funky-haired, you know, kind of edgy-looking guy, white dude, a guy that looked like I used to beat him up in high school, came up, and he sat down next to me. And he struck up a sincere and genuine conversation, and he began to tell me how God had transformed his life. And I had no idea that something like that could take place, especially in a young person. And then he began to tell me how God could transform my life too, and he began to tell me about this person, Jesus, and how he had a purpose and plan for my life. So I began to follow this guy around like a little puppy across campus, and not only was he preaching the gospel to me, but he was actually living his faith out wholeheartedly on a campus that was telling him to do everything but live for God. I mean, 18, 19, 20-year-old college students living right with Jesus. And that had been something that I thought was never possible. And so I looked at his life. I looked at the life of Christ. And I was like, yes. man, this is finally something worth living for. So I gave my life to Christ July 12, 2003, and the rest was history after that. God transformed my life completely from the inside out, and my life has never been the same. So much that I would give my life now to going back to college campuses and want to see that same type of transformation take place in other people's lives. So that's one of the main reasons why I love the college campus, was because that was the first place that I had really encountered God. And the second reason why I love the college campus is because the college campus is one of the few places in all the world where there is a large mass of faithful, available, and trainable leaders in the next generation. You know, I love it was that just as I'm looking out here across the crowd, man, I have no idea who I'm looking at. And when I say that, I don't mean in terms of name or where you're from or what your background is or what your major is, but I'm talking about future leaders of society. And that really gets me excited as I look across this crowd and see your guys' faces. And I really have a heart to see you guys grow and to develop and to be every single thing that God has created you to be. You know, as mentioned earlier, I serve as a campus minister with Call to Greatness Campus Ministries, and we really desire to see students discover, build, and live a life of greatness as found in Christ Jesus. But one of the things that I really found, particularly on the college campus, that's really hindering students from fully entering in and being all that God has created them to be, is that there's an identity crisis going on, okay? An identity crisis. It's something that I struggled with, not only when I was a student athlete and a regular student, but it's something that I still see prevalent on many, many college campuses today that I get a chance to visit. So you might be asking yourself, what is this identity crisis? What does it mean, and what does it look like, and how does it apply to my generation? How does it even apply to this campus here at Ottawa? And so I'm not going to come up with some long academic definition of what an identity crisis is, but when you boil it down, okay, it's very basic, okay, an identity crisis is basically a confusion or a distortion in the understanding of who you are and what you were made to be. It's being confused, having a distorted view or paradigm on who you are and what you were created to be. And this has significant implications, not only for your life, it has significant implications on how you guys view other people's lives, and it has significant implications on how you guys live your lives in the identity that you view yourself in. And so that's why I'm so passionate to be able to speak with you guys and help you to overcome this identity crisis, and hopefully by tonight you guys will understand who you are and what you were created to do and be. And so thinking about this, what it looked like in my life. Now, I know we've got a lot of student athletes here. Okay, I appreciate you guys coming. I know that there's a lot of different places you could be on a Thursday night. Glad you guys came. But athletes, man, we are one of the people who have the greatest identity crisis in all different backgrounds and aspects. And the identity crisis that most of us suffer from is thinking that our identity is solely wrapped up completely in our athletic performance. And that's something that I really, really struggled with. That you found your identity in being an athlete. It starts maybe in grade school, where you find yourself maybe being the fastest kid or the tallest kid. And you grow on to excel in high school, and you begin to play competitively, and you're recognized as being the varsity athlete, and then you're recognized and getting a scholarship, maybe to come to this university. And you're recognized as an athlete. And as people begin to identify you as that, the danger is you begin to solely identify yourself as an athlete as well. And I'm certain that God has created you to be so much more than that. But when you solely find your identity in who you are and how you perform on the court, what happens is that you have a roller coaster wave of emotions. I can remember it. Man, having my identity wrapped up in my performance, what would happen? When I would play good, I'd be feeling good. And when I would play bad, have a bad game, I'd be down in the dumps. I'd be depressed. Man, if I was healthy, if my body was feeling good, if I was 100%, wasn't missing games, wasn't missing practices, My identity, my self-worth was really feeling good. It was really elevated. But maybe if I was struggling, if I had to miss a few games, if I was stuck doing rehab and recovery, man, I was down in the dumps. Open up the newspaper, or maybe this day and age, scroll through Twitter, and you see people talking about you, how great your performance was, what type of awards and accolades you got. What happens with that? You're feeling really good. You're on cloud nine. But then when you're overlooked, when you're underappreciated, when you're undervalued, maybe by the media, your teammates, or students on campus, you find yourself down the dumps. Again, you get on this roller coaster wave of emotions. And you know, it was actually so bad for me that I was one of those types of players that was so selfish that if the team won and I played bad, I'd be in a bad mood. But if the team lost and I played well, I'd be okay with it. That's how much my identity was solely wrapped up in my performance. And that was not the way that God had created us to live. And not only that, I wasn't helping my team one bit, wrapped up in that selfishness, wrapped up solely in that athletic performance and identity. And so it's really important to make sure we break that. Because ultimately what's going to happen is for all of us, and it's inevitable for every single athlete, is one day you're going to find yourself in a life without athletics. I mean, that's one of the few things that's guaranteed for every single athlete. Life without athletics. Your eligibility is going to run out. Your athleticism isn't going to be as sharp. Your game IQ is going to dwindle. The applause of the crowd and the affections of people are going to be silent. And when that takes place, if your identity is solely wrapped up in your performance, or maybe lack thereof, maybe your lack of performance, what are you guys going to do then? Where is your identity? Where is your significance? Where is your value going to hinge? And I tell you what, I know where it's going to end up. Does the name Uncle Rico ring a bell to any of you guys? Here's some of you guys chuckling. 2004, the movie Napoleon Dynamite. You guys remember that? You guys are what, in high school, grade school? Napoleon Dynamite. Who all saw the movie Napoleon Dynamite? Almost everybody in here, okay? And as I watched that movie, a lot of folks, you know, they felt sorry for Napoleon. They felt sorry for Pedro because they were getting picked on. But you know who I felt the sorriest for was Uncle Rico. I mean, how sad was that guy? 45-year-old man living in the past. All he was talking about was how things didn't play out for him in the state championship game in high school. Setting up a camera, filming himself, trying to relive the glory days. Man, that's a prime example cinematically of someone who found their identity solely wrapped up in their athletic performance. And once that time ended, once that time had passed them by, they remained back in the past and they were no longer able to move on to a greater identity. And that's why it's so important. I know no one wants to end up like an Uncle Rico in here. No one wants to be that guy when you go back to a team reunion, a team function, and all you can talk about was the good old days. And you have nothing to show for what's ahead of you. You know, I enjoy being around and connecting with former teammates and having reunions and things like that, but I fully believe that my best days are ahead of me. Man, the college years were fun. The athletic years were great. The championships and the game ones were really satisfying being a part of. Man, but you can't remain there in that place. So if you can't find your identity solely wrapped in your athletic performance, who should you turn to? Where can you go to find your true identity? And I fully believe that you have to go to your Creator to find your identity and your purpose. That you can turn to the Word of God, that you can turn to the Lord God Almighty to find out exactly who you are and what you were created to do and be. You have to turn to your Creator. Because once you turn to your Creator, then you will find your true identity and then you'll find your true purpose. So here, just a real quick example of what that looks like, okay? I know every one of you has a cell phone. I want everyone to pull that cell phone out right now, if you don't have it out already, all right? I know your attention's drawn to it. If you need to shoot a text, if you need to shoot a tweet, that's okay. I've been working with college students. I know that's just a general event. I'm completely okay with that. But here it is. All you guys have your cell phone, your mobile device in your hand. All right. Somewhere, someone created this thing for a specific purpose, a specific intent. All right. What's in your hand? Nowhere or no time along the line can you or even this phone itself decide that it wants to be something that it wasn't created to be. I could take this thing. I could set it on this podium. I could go back to your dorm room. I could get a cold slice of pizza. I could throw it on this cell phone, and I could think that this thing is a microwave. I could set the timer on here for 3 minutes, but no matter what I do, no matter how hard I try, no matter how hard that phone tries, it will never, ever be a microwave. Now, someone's probably going to go report this to Apple, and the iPhone 12 will be a microphone. There'll be a microwave feature on it. But for the time being, all right, for the time being, this phone was created with a specific purpose to do a specific thing, and it can't be anything else. And more importantly, this phone was made with a specific purpose, and it was to be in the hand of an individual. All right, you could try to say, hey, this thing is a paperweight. You know, this thing is a coaster. Once you separate that device from where it was specifically intended to be in the hand of an individual, it can no longer function in the purpose it was created for. It might get a few notifications, might ring, text message might come through, but ultimately what's going to happen is it's not going to fulfill its purpose, the battery's going to run out, it's going to die, and it's going to be useless. So I'm sharing this analogy with you and hoping that you guys will understand the very same thing applies to your life. Man, the Lord God Almighty created each and every one of you guys in here with a specific intent, with a specific purpose in life. And as hard as you may try, as much as you may want to go off and do your own thing, to live your own way, to look at media and the pop culture and say, yes, I want to do that, I want to live that way, no matter how hard you guys try to go against that grain, you're not going to be able to live and fulfill that purpose. Number one, apart from God, okay, apart from his hand of providence and goodness and blessing, and apart from his kingdom purposes that are found in the Bible. So if you guys want to find your true identity, who you are and who you were created to be, look no further than the Lord God Almighty. Look no further than what his word has to say for your life. Because when you fully enter into the purposes and plans that he has for you, man, then you guys are able to experience true joy, true success, lasting fulfillment. You're not only able to impact your own life, but you're able to impact the lives of the people around you. Not just for a single moment, not just for a season, not just providing entertainment for some fans, but you guys have the opportunity and the ability to be a part of something that lasts forever. And that's exciting. You guys get a chance to be a part of a team that will never lose. I know all of you guys are competitors in here. No one likes to lose. And the purposes of God are victorious in every single way. If you want to be on a winning team, man, give yourself to the things, the purposes of God. So getting back to what I was saying about finding your identity and finding your purpose, I want to take a look at a few scripture verses that will help us come to that understanding of what our identity is and what we were made to do and be. And the first one I want to draw your attention to is in the story of creation, Genesis chapter 1 and 2. Okay, right from the beginning, there's no better place to start than from the very beginning. And when I think about the purposes, when I think about the identity of man, this was the first thing that came to mind. And it's found, this scripture verse, in Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 through 27. Would you guys listen in as I read this? And here we see prior to this, we see God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit working intricately together, creating the foundations of the world. And here, they get to the creation of man. And we get a chance to listen in on their conversation and hear what they say. And the story picks up in verse 26. And God says, he says, "Let us make man in our own image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, and over the livestock and the creepy crawler things that move along the ground." So God created all of mankind in his image, and in the image of God, he created them, both male and female. And so that might seem like a very basic story, very basic scripture verse. Many of you probably heard of that growing up in Sunday school, and you might blow it off and say, "Yeah, I've heard that before. That's a familiar passage. That's a Sunday school story. I made a stick figure out of that one time, out of some popsicle sticks." But it's so much more than that. Man, this is the Word of God from the very beginning telling us the true identity and the true purpose of mankind. And I love how it goes on to say that we are made in the image of God. Right off the bat. Man, your identity is as image bearers of God. And when I think of an image, probably one of the first things that comes to mind is looking in a mirror. When you stand in front of a mirror, you are reflecting an image off that mirror right back to yourself. And we could think of ourselves as being made in the likeness of God, not merely in a physical frame, but that we are called to reflect God's goodness, and God's love, and God's mercy, God's kindness, God's humility. We are meant to reflect God's character in all of the earth. Man, he chose to make us in his image. What an incredible privilege. Even as you guys take a look at the rest of the creation account, man, it tells us that the Lord God, all he did, he spoke. Man, let there be light. There was light. Let the waters and the earth separate. And it happened. Man, let the sun and the moon and the stars be hung and shine. But yet when it came to mankind, not only did he make us in his image, but it actually says that he formed us with his hand. Man, detailed, intimate relationship with you guys. Again, being made in his likeness. So a part of our identity is being image bearers of the character of God in all the earth. And the purpose behind that is, and it goes on to say, he did it for the purpose so that they would rule. So that they would have dominion. So that they would exercise responsibility and stewardship over God's creation. I mean, think about that. Man, this incredible earth that God created, he has entrusted it to us. And not only the earth, but also reflecting his image to so many people. Man, what a high calling. What an incredible identity and purpose that he instilled to us right off the bat in creation. So, man, we could find our identity right there. Again, I want to continue moving on, thinking about this thought of what our identity and our purpose is. One of my favorite scripture verses pertaining to this topic is found in Galatians chapter 2, verse 10. And here we find the Apostle Paul speaking, and he's telling us, and he says, "For you," okay, this is speaking directly to you guys, okay, this just wasn't some book that was written thousands of years ago that was talking to some men a long time ago that has no application, no relevance to here today, but make this personal, guys. Man, the Lord is speaking to you right here now through his word. And listen into this because this is so encouraging. God says, "For you are God's masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus to do good works which God has prepared in advance for you to do." I mean, think about that identity. God is calling you his masterpiece. Do you guys have an understanding what a masterpiece is? It's something that's handmade. It's something that's one of a kind. It's something that's worth immense value. And God is speaking that about you right here and now. You're not merely a scholarship athlete. You're not a walk-on. You're not merely a starter. You're not merely a physical education major or a biology major. Man, God is calling you His masterpiece. And even thinking about how important and how valuable a masterpiece is, you guys are so valuable that you had to be bought with the most precious thing. And it wasn't found in any monetary system. It wasn't cash money. It wasn't silver or gold. It wasn't a check or a credit card. But your life was purchased through the blood of Christ. The most potent and powerful currency the earth has ever seen, the blood of Jesus Christ. That's how valuable you guys are. So don't sell yourself short. Don't let anyone tell you that you're nothing. Don't let anyone tell you that you're not worth anything. Because here we see in God's very own word, He's saying that you are your masterpiece. Doesn't matter how many points you score. Doesn't matter if you're a starter or a non-starter. You are God's masterpiece. And then He goes on to say, well, what's the purpose of that? We have our identity as a masterpiece, but what is the purpose for? And that scripture verse goes on to say that God has done that because He has prepared good works in advance for you to do. Man, God has given you incredible things to be able to do on this earth and in your life. You know, one of the most rewarding things of all time is to be able to accomplish work. It might not be fun going through it at the moment, but think about how good you guys feel after a good, solid practice. After a great day of conditioning. Maybe after you guys max out on some different exercises, you get some extra reps in. Sure, it may be difficult. Sure, you may be tired or fatigued. But the feeling of accomplishing work, the feeling of growing together as a team, the feeling of being victorious, man, that's a great feeling. And you know what? God created that feeling. And He's given you guys good works to do. Again, in seeing His purposes advance. Man, He's got great things He wants to do with your life here and now. It's not just about being a Christian and then trying to play it safe and have a case of the do-gooders until you die and maybe go to heaven one day. But God wants to use you to advance His kingdom here on this earth, here on this campus, on your teams, in your dorms, in the businesses that you guys are going to go on to lead one day, in your families, as many of you are going to be husbands and wives and fathers and mothers. Man, the Lord's got great work for you to do. And as you guys understand your purpose and your identity in Him, then you can go on to do that great work for Him. And I tell you what, I've been a part of a lot of championship teams, and the most fulfilling and satisfying work that I've ever done, that I've ever been a part of, is things like this. Being able to be here and to share with you guys tonight. Again, because it's of eternal value. It's of eternal significance. And not just something that'll fade away. It's not just a fleeting moment. You know, Dave had alluded to the world championship team that I had to be a part of. And if there is one thing that I learned in the NBA during that whole time, if there's one reason why I feel like God had me go to the NBA to be a part of that team, it was to teach me that athletic success, the athletic prestige, the athletic achievement fades away real fast. And this is a story that I always try to tell to athletes. So we find ourselves in the NBA Finals. We're playing against the Dallas Mavericks. We're down 2-0 in the NBA Finals. We lost home court advantage. We got our backs against the ropes, and we're fighting to stay alive in the playoffs. Miraculously, we come back. We win 4 games straight, and we beat the Dallas Mavericks on their home court in Game 6. So I think we did that maybe on a Tuesday night. We stayed in Dallas, celebrated, then we flew back to Miami on Thursday to get ready for the championship parade and celebration. And it was amazing that as we were there, the who's who of the media interviewed in about 10 different languages. The city of Miami is flooded with tens of thousands of fans. It's 90 degrees outside. There's fireworks. There's confetti. We've got these huge water cannons. We're spraying the fan. It's an amazing spectacle. winding in and out of downtown Miami. We return to American Airlines Arena. We come up on stage, and a few of the prominent players and coaches get ready to address the team. And it's amazing how all the media could talk about during our interviews was who's coming back next year, are you going to do it again next year? About 10 minutes of being outside with the crowd on the floats, and they all started chanting, repeat, repeat, repeat. And then a couple of the coaches and the big-time players on the team, they took the mic, and what did they talk about? They guaranteed that we were going to do the same thing next year. I mean, here it is, guys. We had just won the NBA World Championship on a Tuesday. And 2 days later, 2 days later, all anyone could ever talk about is, are we going to do it again next year? I mean, think about how fleeting that was. 2 days. Fast-forwarding on to the beginning of that season, first game of the year, Commissioner Stearns in the house. He gives us our championship rings. We hoist the championship banner up into the rafters. Chicago Bulls are waiting in the locker room next to us. They could care less about what we had accomplished the year before. The Chicago Bulls come out and they blow us out by 40 points on our home court. First nationally televised NBA game of the season. Our home fans boo us off the court as we're walking back into the locker room. 48 minutes earlier, they were just singing our praises for being champions. 48 minutes after, they're booing us off the court. We had a terrible year that year. Same team, Shaquille O'Neal, Dwayne Wade, Alonzo Mourning, Gary Payton, barely squeaking to the playoffs. Chicago Bulls, first round, they sweep us 4-0 in the first round of the NBA playoffs. Defending champions swept in the first round. And believe you me, our home fans were not happy about that. They certainly weren't cheering for us. So I remember going back to the locker room, putting my hands in my head and wondering, man, Lord, what just took place? What just happened? Where did that season go? Where did the joy, where did the elation, where did the excitement go? And the Lord reminded me of a scripture verse in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 24, and it talks about man and all his glory. All the things that he can attain, all the awards, all the accolades, all the fame, all the money, everything that you guys may be trying to attain. Man and all his glory are like the grass and the flowers of the field. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but it's only the word and the will of God that stands forever. And I remember coming to that reality in that locker room and making a resolve and thinking, Lord, I'm going to give my life fully to your purposes and to your ways, to something that's going to last forever, to something that's not going to fade away in a moment's time, to your kingdom work. Because I tell you what, if at the end of your guy's life, all you can say was that you hit a few home runs, that you won a few matches, maybe you were all conference, maybe you're all American, if that's all you can say for your college career, if that's all you can say for your entire life, that is a life wasted. Because God created you for so much more than that. Again, you're his masterpiece, and he's given you kingdom work to accomplish. Man, I love how it says in John chapter 17, as Jesus Christ was getting ready to go to the cross, he was praying for his disciples, he was praying for the believers, and then he began to pray to the Father. And he said, Father, Lord, I have completed the work that you had given me. Now glorify me with the glory that we once shared before the foundations of the world. And if you guys can say that at the end of your life, God, I have completed the work that you have given me, then that's a life worth living. And that starts here today, guys, on this campus, right here now in this building. It's not something that you have to wait to do when you get older. It's not something that you have to wait to do until you get your life together and you clean up your sins. It's something that you guys could do right here and now. Man, commit yourself to God, to his kingdom work. Understand that you're his masterpiece, and he's got great things for you to do. And lastly, finishing up here, the last area of identity that I want to talk about is understanding that we are sons and daughters of God. You know, it's amazing as we look at the Gospel of John, and this scripture verse is so encouraging to me. In John chapter 1, verses 12 and 13. Here it is. It says that yet all who received Jesus, to those who believe in his name, he gave the right to be called children of God. Children not born of natural descent, nor human decision, nor man's will, but born of God. It's even encouraging to take a look at Romans chapter 8, verse 15, where it says that the Spirit that we received through Christ does not make us slaves to fear. Fear in the future. Fearing injury. Fearing of being fearful of uncertainty. Being fearful of man. Being fearful of the approval of other people. Man, the Spirit that God has given us through Jesus does not make us a slave to those things. But it goes on to say that the Spirit that we receive through Christ is a spirit of adoption, where we can call God Abba or Father. I mean, that just blows my mind, thinking that we can actually call the Lord God Almighty himself, we can call him Father through faith in Christ. You know what? No matter what your situation or your background or your relationship might be with your own dad, maybe you had a great dad growing up, maybe your dad wasn't around, maybe he was supportive in your athletics, maybe he rode you too hard, maybe he lived vicariously through you, maybe he had addictions, maybe he was abusive, whatever the case may be, good dad or bad dad. And how great is it that through faith in Christ, we can actually call God our Father? I mean, what an identity for you guys to embrace. I am a son and daughter of the living God. That's a true identity worth walking in. It's not something that you say pridefully, but it's something that you can stand up and say with dignity. You can hold your head up and declare, yes, I'm a son and daughter of God through Christ. And that it's through that, man, you can have a purpose of joining in to the Father's business, of doing what our Heavenly Father is doing. That's what Jesus oftentimes spoke about, that he came not to do his will, but to do the will of the one who sent him, which is his Father. I've got four kids, a 4-, 3-, 2-year-old, and a 12-week-old. And it delights my heart so much when I see them imitate me. It's kind of self-seeking. It might sound a little conceited, but it's pretty cool. My wife doesn't really like it when they imitate me getting on the NFL officials. My God, oh, come on, it's interception. Next thing you know, my son's watching Blue's Clues. He's like, oh, come on, no, it's the letter B. No. Then my wife looks at me with that eye, and she knows exactly where she got it from. My bad, honey, I'm sorry. But, man, it delights my heart to see my kids imitate the things that I'm doing, to see them want to play basketball, to see them, even though they can't read, to go to Daddy's bookshelf and get the Bible and open it up and try to read it. And that delights my heart. Man, how much more does our Father in heaven delight when we try to imitate him? When we try to do the things that he does, when we try to reflect his character and his image in every single part of our life. And understanding that you have a great identity through Jesus Christ, and being able to call God your Father, being sons and daughters, and that because of that, you could find a purpose in doing the Father's work here on earth. So if you guys are here today and you find yourself like me a long time ago, having their identity wrapped solely in their athletic performance, and you know what, for maybe some athletes, some non-athletes here, you can pretty much insert anything you want into that category. It's not just athletics. If you find your identity and your worth and your value in your GPA, if you find your worth or identity or your value in your major, maybe your past successes, your past failures, where you're headed, relationships that you have, it's all going to end up in the same place. That identity crisis is going to prevail, and it's all going to leave you empty, broken, and hurt. But it's only when you embrace, when you accept the true identity that God has given you through Christ, being made in his image, being his masterpiece, being his sons and daughters, and the Bible talks about many more, as you embrace the identity that God has given you, then that's when you're truly able to live and to walk in the purpose of greatness. You know, just even thinking about Ottawa University, how they value preparing you guys for a life of significance. If that life of significance is merely found in leaving this campus with a diploma or a few relationships or a couple of wins under your belt, some memories that you're able to make, then again, you guys are really missing out on all that God has for you. But as you guys would pursue Him, as you would pursue Christ and grow in a knowledge and a faith in Him, man, finding your purpose and your identity in and through Jesus Christ, that's the first step to true significance. That's the first step to eternal significance. That's a step of leaving a legacy that's far greater than wins or losses, championships or individual accolades. So I would encourage you guys, as you go throughout this season, even as many of you guys go back to your dorm room tonight and you think about this message, maybe even in your seat as you do business with God, man, have that identity that's found outside of Christ. Have that broken off of you. Man, push that aside and really find your true purpose and your worth and your identity and who God has made you to be. And become a person of influence. Become a person of eternal worth and value. And go on to be the great person that God has created you to be in every single way, in every single area of life. Man, don't be an Uncle Rico. Man, don't be a former champion. Be someone who's continually giving their life to the things of God and walking in those purposes in every way. Amen? Amen. Well, great. Well, I hope you guys are encouraged and challenged by that. Would you guys just bow your heads in a quick word of prayer for me? I just want to ask the Lord to seal this in our hearts. And even if you need to take some time, and I'm just going to be silent here for a moment. And I know for many of you guys, silence might seem a little awkward because of so much chatter on social media, through your phones, through the airwaves. But just take this moment, man, just to quiet yourself before the Lord and to allow Him to show you if your identity is in the right place and where it needs to be. And if that's not the case, man, ask Him that He would break into your life and to exchange that identity with the identity that He truly has for you that's found in Christ. Why don't you guys just take a moment. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank You for Your presence here tonight. God, we thank You that each and every one of these students, Lord, each and every one of these faculty and community members, God, that they are not here by accident. Lord, that You brought them here to this place tonight for a specific purpose and a specific reason. God, and we just ask that You would do an incredible work in each and every person's heart here tonight. Lord, I thank You that You've given us so much to live for, so much to look forward to. God, that You've given us a great and unshakable identity that's found in Your Son, Jesus Christ. God, and for those here tonight that have their identity placed in any other area other than Christ, Lord, I ask that You would come in and that You would change their heart. Lord, whether it's an athletic performance, whether it's a relationship that they're in, whether it's a goal or a dream that they have, whether it's a past failure or success, Lord, we know that having our identity in that is going to leave us flat on our face at some point in some time. God, but it's by Your Son, Lord, it's by Your Spirit that we can find our true identity in You. And we can find our true purpose and true fulfillment in who You've called and created us to be. You know, I just even get the sense that, man, there's some of you guys here that that are struggling with the identity of Christ. Who is this man? What is it about him? Is he just a Sunday school character? Is he just a historical figure? Is he just a man pointing to God? And Lord, for those people here who are here tonight wrestling with this identity of Christ, Lord, I just ask that you would reveal yourself to them in a great and mighty way. That you would reveal yourself to them as Lord. That you would reveal yourself to them as Savior and as King, as rightful ruler of the earth, that they would give their lives to you right here and now. That they would commit to follow and serve you. That they would accept the gift of your salvation. That they would accept the sacrifice that was paid for them by the shedding of your blood. And that they would go on to be all that you created them to be. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hey, well, again, well, thanks for coming out tonight, guys. I know that I'm just up in the road in Lawrence, about 20 miles away. If I can be of service to you guys, if I can be a resource to you, feel free to hit me up, social media, Facebook, Twitter. And I want to hear about what the Lord's done in your heart tonight. I want to hear about you guys going on to walk in that identity and that purpose. And, of course, I want, hopefully you guys want to hear about you going on to have great seasons this year. So I hope you guys are blessed. I hope you guys are encouraged. Go on to have a great season. Go on to walk in identity in Christ and purpose in Christ in all that you do. All right. Thank you, guys.
Wayne, thank you so much for being here with us tonight. I do want to just say to you that about 100 years ago, Ottawa University and KU played each other in basketball, and Ottawa won. That was probably the last time they won. But in any event, there's been a long history between KU and Ottawa, and we appreciate so much you coming down to share with us tonight. And we've got a small memento here for you to take home back up the road to Lawrence. And we hope you'll take that along. And we also have some gifts here for your family. And we'll pass those along to you, too.
Thank you.
Thank you.
As we get ready to close in prayer, I hope we appreciated the words of Wayne tonight. While he was speaking, I was thinking of a devotional I've been reading by Tony Dungy, the former NFL coach. I believe it's entitled Uncommon. And he said the main reason we should come to college is not to find a career, but to find our purpose. And I know the words that Wayne shared tonight spoke to some of you. You heard exactly what you've been looking for years. So don't let it go to waste. Find a coach, Pastor Bud, some man or woman that will share the gospel with you. Shall we pray? Dear Father, your word doesn't return empty. You know us better than you know us, than we know ourselves. The simple gospel that you died for our sins and rose again to give us life, more than we can ever hope to have. Give us a safe journey, and may your love and your forgiveness and your grace go with us now and forevermore. Continue to anoint Wayne that he might share your good news, and may the seeds planted tonight produce fruit that will last forever and ever. For I ask this in the name of my Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
You're dismissed.